supposed to be going to Lamont's wedding next year too in Mexico. In Mexico. This one I'm like medium and Facebook I'm dark.
It's the lighting, y'all. It's the lighting.
That's funny. Got me out here. All right, like we
Princess of all.
And I'm Cujo Speaks.
And we are here on the Gud Tymez Show.
We are.
And we got a lot to talk about.
Oh man.
Sorry I had to add this on back to it, but that's real quick because I just cut it out so we can come on. But listen y'all, let's see. It's we only got a few more minutes or hours.
It'd be going so quick.
I know. That's cause, you know, we got the gift of gab.
Man, we do.
Once we start talking, you know, we can point out anything. Y'all can give us a topic and we can go blow for blow on a Gud Tymez Show.
Ooh,
you already know. Bars. And if you didn't know, now you know.
Hey. If you don't know, now you know.
We're talented like that. But, all right, let's get into some of these topics, all right, y'all? Because the last time we came back, we were posting into topics, and then I don't know what we said about that. But, you know, we just started talking to y'all. So, first things first. So, when I first met this young feller here, he went by the name of something else, which was D. Clement.
Yes,
so, what was the name change? For the listeners who maybe be like, oh my gosh, I remember him a few years ago. He was on the mixtape. The Gud Tymez Show mixtape and all that stuff.
It's
so,
the same guy. That's
it's me. The same him, but different name. What happened with the name
change? So, the name D. Clemens in the beginning, when I went to L.A., I got out of the military and went to L.A., and I was like, well, I need a rap name, right? Mm-hmm. So, I had nobody calling me nothing at the time besides Mad Child. When I was 12 years old, my brother had me writing, and that's when I started, and they called me Mad Child. Well, as a 27-year-old man, I couldn't be Mad Child, so I've decided on...
We got Lil Baby. We got Lil Baby.
I actually saw someone come out recently whose name is Mad Child, and I was real heated about
that. Oh, my goodness.
I was mad.
That's crazy.
I decided that D. Clemens would stand for Detroit, and then apostrophe Clemens, which sounds for Mount Clemens, and I grew up in between those two cities.
Okay.
You know, I always kind of hated people being like, I'm from Detroit when you live in Mount Clemens or you live in Clinton Township. You know, people don't like you fronting on the city. So that was that. And then I never really loved that name. So one day I'm just sitting there and the first dog I ever had, his name is Cujo. And I've always loved the name Cujo.
But it is a very unique and different name.
Cujo's no longer with us.
I figured
Cujo needs to have a voice. You need that dog. The dog inside of me needs to start barking and stop being so nice.
Let's do it for Coo.
Yeah, you know, so I kind of just made it up and came up with it, but at the same time, it was a way for me to finally start speaking up for myself and being a boisterous person for myself in music and in life.
That's what's up.
So as not deep as it is, it's kind of deep, I guess.
But you want to know what's crazy? I never knew that's what D. Clemens stood for.
You know, everybody always thought that was my last name.
I did. Because I know your first name. So
people,
I thought that was...
LA used to call me Mr. Clemens and all that.
I thought it was just your, you know, first initial last name.
Yeah.
So this is up. See, people, listen. We learn something new every single day, okay? Mm-hmm. Every single day. Now, speaking of learning something new every single day, Meek Mill has definitely taken that, and I would say times 10, okay? Yeah. He's definitely not the Meek that we've seen previous years ago.
The Meek of old.
Yeah, he's the new Meek. And I mean, I think that, you know, with age and wisdom, that's how it should be and that's how it's supposed to be. But he did an interview, was it, where he was like, it was a bunch of things that he was talking about.
He sent the tweet out first. So there's a bunch of different controversy and things surrounding Meek right now. And it's good for him because I believe he has an album coming out shortly.
Yes, he does.
So I will say I think all of these things that are happening are on purpose. It's not like he's just caught up in some mess.
Don't people always do that? Like, they somehow find a way to make it into the media around the time.
If you have a good PR team, then you go see him in the news quite a bit before an album launches. So the first thing I want to talk about is what he said about Squid Games. You know, Squid Games is the hottest show out. If you haven't seen Squid Games, go check it out on Netflix. The hype is real. I decided to watch it with my wife, and at first we couldn't get past the, because it is in its native tongue, and it has the American overdub on it. I couldn't get past that at first, but once you get past it, the show is brutal. It's well done. It's well shot. Great show. The gist of it is they put a bunch of people in a room, and they play kid games, and if you fail or you don't win the game, you die. And it's all for money. So he was saying that Squid Games is basically exactly what the hood is, and poverty in the hood is exactly the same. And I think he was even trying to say that they were trying to put a spotlight on that. I mean,
they could have. I mean, because they're from China. I mean, because it's overseas. I don't know. But, I mean, if that's his interpretation.
Mm-hmm. And it was. And he said that if you were to put African Americans in the place of these Asian individuals, that the show would have been a different show, would have been talked about differently, and would have been more controversial, which I can't say he's wrong, but I just found it interesting, and I don't know if I agree fully, but I don't disagree fully. It was one of those that, like, you hear it, and you're like, ooh.
Okay, that's a thought.
I see that.
So, in my opinion, I feel like with TV shows, movies, all those kinds of things, you know, we have to stop criticizing and we have to stop shaming people for having an opinion and an outlook of their perspective.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? No two people or no one person will ever see something the way that you see it. Even as a director, you can shoot the movie this way. You can tell people, this is what the movie is about. People are still going to see it from their own perspective. So I feel like that's where we need to start, for one. For two, if he feels like watching that show made him think about the inner city, who are we to say you shouldn't think that way or no, it does not? Because, I mean, honestly speaking, I mean, it is. When you think about the inner cities and the inner hoods and, you know, those type of areas, it is a dog-eat-dog world. Not because some of them choose to be that way, but some of them are, you know, forced to be that way in a sense. Yeah. I mean, it's that whole nature versus nurture. Like, at the end of the day, I always say this, no one is born a racist. No one is born a killer. No one is born a thug. Situations and life situations turn them into what they have become.
Yeah, absolutely. You can't, there's no way that can deny that fact.
Yeah.
I mean, so people that argue about nature versus nurture, I mean, they're talking about very tiny situations, I think.
Yeah.
I mean, in a vast sense, you have to, your environment is going to shape you into who you are.
Exactly.
There's a few people that make it out of those environments and don't get caught in that rat race, but you can't deny that what you're around, you eventually will either become or succumb to.
And that's how the inner cities is. So, you know, I have not seen Squid Games. I was going to call it Squad Games. I have not.
You talk about the hood version of it. You talk about the one on BET.
That would have been the hood version of Squad Games. I have not seen that, but just the concept of everything that I've been seeing on the TikToks and people talking about it, it does remind me of that because I'm going to try to one up you, do whatever I can to beat you to reach this prize. Mm-hmm. The prize of getting out the hood, getting money.
Right. And what he said was, so the tweet that initially came out that sparked this whole thing was, Squid Games, pay attention how fast people switch and kill each other to survive. Now think about the hood poverty. It's the exact same thing. If you just help them with work/money, they won't be that way. Just a common sense message. And then, of course, all kinds of people are coming after him. Like, you gotta quit using that excuse of blah, 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 blah. But what he's saying is, because in Squid Games, there's people are killing each other to try to get people dead faster, because whoever's alive gets the whole pot.
And how can you look at that and say that that's not right. Thank even if you look, okay, even if you don't go into the hood realm, look at Selena.
Right.
That woman literally killed her because she wanted to be her. I want the fame you have. I don't want you to have it. You know what I'm saying? So that is real life. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. Someone would literally snitch on their best friend. Okay, let's do another sample example. Think about the whole Megan Thee Stallion, her best friend, and Tory Lanez situation, right? We still don't really know what happened, but bottom line is, everyone was like, oh, her best friend sold her out to Tory Lanez, oh, her best friend did this, da, 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 da.
Right.
And we don't know if the best friend really did it or not, but I'm using that as an example to show people will switch up on their best friend, their family member, for money.
Yeah.
People will sell their kids for money. So he's right. If you help people with money and work and all those kinds of things, it wouldn't be such a dog-eat-dog world, because to them, it's only a limited amount of money, which we know that there's, you know, infinities amounts of money out right there. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's enough money to go around for everybody.
I say it all the time, and I'm going to keep saying it. I think that's going to be my catchphrase, is everybody can eat.
Yes.
Like you said, people, it's like they own, there's only $1 million out here for y'all to go get. Now, who's going to get the most of it? You know what
exactly.
I'm saying?
Exactly. Like, it's enough for everybody.
There's so much money out here. So much.
And I mean, that honestly goes into what we were talking about when we first opened the show.
Right.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, someone would literally not promote your brand because they think it's going to stop their money flow.
That's
not the case.
I've never understood it. And maybe that's why I wouldn't survive in the hood, because I'd be trying to give everybody, you know what I'm saying? Hey, take this advice. Go to this corner. That's where it's hottest at. Like, come on.
I mean, but, you know, I do understand the flip side of some of those people saying, you know, that's not true, because we've all seen within the last year people get money and make money that they were not maybe privy to or accustomed to before. And because they got money, they didn't do the right things with it.
Yeah.
So I see it on both ends. I see the end of, yes, that show does remind you of the inner cities. Now the end where it's like, if you gave people money and a chance to it up, they would be better. That part, it's like, that's a toss up.
That's where it sucks at, because I feel like the opportunity, you have to give the opportunity. I don't feel like you should give people money. Like, I always think about, if I win $500 million, right?
Mm-hmm.
Even my family, like, you know, mom, brother, sister, I'm not going to drop them millions of dollars at one time. You know what I'm saying? Because that amount of money can drive somebody crazy, and you end up doing some, you know, irresponsible things. So I would rather, okay, here, let me help you set this business up, or I'll pay off your bills, or let me set you up with something that's going to continue to get you fun.
But that's what a lot of people don't want to work towards.
Right.
And I've found that out over the course of my entrepreneurship and my journey of wanting to help people. People just want you to do it for them.
Yeah, oh yeah.
They don't want you to really teach them how to do it so that they can make a lucrative and
right.
and be successful type of thing. And that's the problem that, you know, we have. Like, you know, yes, giving people money, but like you said, money is not going to solve the problem if you don't know how to maintain
I want to help solve the issue and create something for you to make sure that issue doesn't come back.
Because all you're doing is putting a band-aid on a temporary situation. Like, you're not solving anything. Jay was telling me not too long ago, he was telling me that, because we were talking about the NBA health fraud that's going on right now. And how a lot of them, you know, they were giving money, they were giving millions, boom, but your career's not going anywhere. You know what I'm saying? And he was saying that Shannon Sharp actually said that, you know, he sat down with his money guy. His money guy told him how much he can spend per month. His money guy was like, look, what do you want to do, you know, when you're 50 and you can't play sports anymore? How do you want to live? And he structured that when he was younger. And he lived on a budget. He was like, people in the NBA would laugh at him when he'd be like, oh, this is my budget per month, I can't go over this. They'd be like, what, dog? You know, spend some cash. But look at him now. He's 50 plus and older. I didn't even know he was over 50. He looks dang good for his age. Mm. But he's over 50, has a career. He's still living comfortably. He's not stressed for cash. You know what I'm saying? But the most people, he's like, I don't need a 10-bedroom house. I bought a 6-bedroom house. Instead of me buying my mom a house, no, we all live together because once you buy someone a house, they can afford them taxes and that rent, like the mortgage. That's so you're going to be on the hook for as well.
People don't get that. You have people to pay don't understand property. Property taxes really are.
Oh, I bought my mom a house, but your mom can afford the mortgage and everything. So you basically bought you a house because you're on the hook, line, and sink for that. Even though you bought it for her, she can't afford it. So when people go out here and there, they're just throwing this cash all around and they're not really thinking about, you know, where it's placing, how it's going to be set up. That's what ultimately, you know, causes, you know, destruction. But, you know, that's rather here nor there. Y'all probably like, if you know what you're talking about, I do know.
No, we know. It's just people don't want to listen.
We speak in actual, factual, okay?
People don't want to listen.
We're trying to give y'all free game.
Free game, okay? Friday. Okay, so I was thinking about this last night, too, just real quick. You want to know something? So real quick, I thought of a formula myself that I was thinking, I teach my kids a lot, and I try to teach my kids how to do it like I now wish I would have.
Yeah.
So instead of getting loans, like, don't get loans at all. Mm-hmm. If you think about it and break it down, the only reason you need a credit score is to get loans.
Yeah.
The only reason you need a loan is to live in or drive something you can't afford.
Yeah.
Right? So if you want to stay out of that, save money. So for that first car, buy you a bucket. Buy a $2,000 car. And each month, put away what your car payment would be until you have enough money to purchase that $20,000, $30,000 vehicle.
Speak back.
After that, you get that $20,000 vehicle. Say you want to save for a house now. Continue to put the payments that you would be willing to pay per month into your savings account until you can buy that cash. Mm-hmm. You'll never be in debt. You'll never owe nobody nothing. And everything you make will go into your pocket.
And how about you look into some CDC funds, some hedge funds, because you would create more of an interest with your money sitting there than your average just banking or savings account.
Just saying.
So you would technically be doubling what your payments would be.
Saying.
You know what I'm saying? Like, people look at me and people may be like, oh, you drive this, you do this, you got that kind of phone, you live here. I don't have no type of credit. I have credit, but I don't owe anybody nothing.
Right.
I don't have a phone payment, okay? I pay cash for my phone. It's a simple Samsung S10, you know what I'm saying? I don't need the 13 Max Pro because you're going to be paying $20 a month.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You're never going to really own that. So I don't have a phone payment. I don't have a car note. All I have is my insurance. I did that. Cash for my car, like, you know what I'm saying? Because, like you said, those type of things is always a hook, line, and sink.
Because people are taught, that's the way we're taught. We're
yeah.
taught to go to college, get your student loans, go to college, get a good job to pay your student loan back, get a nice car, get a nice home. I'm just telling you, that's how they teach you to. That's how they teach you to do it. So, I mean, unless somebody comes around and actually breaks it down for you, someone that you can trust, which I hope y'all can trust us.
Yes.
Everybody's going to continue to do that.
And, you know, me and Jay and, you know, my family, we're always talking about, you know, different ways of, you know, how to help. And, you know, we're working on a way to be able to help people who necessarily, you know, don't go to college. You know what I'm saying? Like, so it's crazy that if you want to go to college, they'll give you a $20,000, $100,000 loan to go to school to rack up debt for a degree that you may or may not use in your career path. But if you wanted to start a small business or invest into yourself, you can't get that $20,000 to $100,000 loan.
You
if you want to go to a trade school, you can't
do that. Most times, you know why they won't give it to you? Because you owe this loan, and you don't make enough yet for them to believe you're going to pay their loan back.
But I don't make anything if I'm a college student. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So you'll give me that loan as a college student, knowing
right.
I don't have no credit, I don't have no job, I really can't work because I'm in college, but you'll give me that loan. But if I tell you that I'm trying to start a business, you won't give me that loan.
Not gonna happen.
So
you know what colleges should do? You know those lawyers are like, you don't pay until you win. Hey, colleges should do that. You don't have to pay us until you get a job
degree.
In the career field that we just charged you for.
Because salary.
7 years.
was strange, LA. You want to get that money. Okay? Oh, not for
poor
me.
Poor Sally. It ain't hurting her body.
Not for me.
Sally
I don't
Rich.
Care who is hurting.
Sally Rich.
So, okay, so although Meek was talking about that, in another interview, he was talking about the cover art of his new album. Did
Man.
You see it?
Yes, on a bus.
With the cartoons and the bus. Okay, so let me make sure that I was, that I looked at the correct one. Because for me,
there was one where they had them, like, the whoever posted it had hearts or whatever over the explicit portions.
The boobs? Okay,
and
was it?
Got the, yeah.
You was
see
it
the,
this?
The female bent over this? With the little pink part?
Okay.
You know what that's
what,
supposed to be.
What? But where's the bus?
So there's a, you have to find the, I'll find it. But the bus has been driving around. Like, parking in places and driving, like, actually out in the city.
So that picture is on a
that
bus.
That is wrapped around an entire, like, imagine a city bus.
Okay, but.
That well, is all over the bus.
So, okay, just help me understand what some of the people are upset about. What's everyone upset about?
Because you're portraying black women like this, bent over with their whatever's out, and this is what you want black women.
Oh, okay.
Right.
Okay, they're mad at the picture.
They're mad at
not the bus.
The fact that he's got it wrapped all over the bus, driving around.
Oh, because of the right. old saying, okay, with the old,
yeah.
the oldness, okay, that they want us to be emotionally still tied to. Things.
Yeah, I guess.
Okay.
And it just kind of took me for a loop, too, because I'm like, okay, you have Cardi B and whoever else doing WAP on, like, the Grammys.
Okay,
right?
That's why I'm like, why is everyone...
But they're going ham, and people are mad. People okay. are really offended by this cover art being on this bus.
So, I read a story where, you know, people sparked opinions. So, rapper Meek Mill is celebrating the success of his fifth studio album, Expensive Pain. The art, it released, it's supposed to drop the day before October 1st. So, this is actually old. I don't know why people are just not getting upset at this. But, however, whatever. While reviewers have called Expensive Pain of Meek Mill's best work, it is the album colorful cover art that is getting him headlines. A video of a Caucasian man in Las Vegas went viral when the rapper's tour bus, which is wrapped with the cover art, drove through his Hollywood neighborhood. The cover art depicts imagery of naked black women, including exposed chestuses and areolas, in abstract versions of private parts. It had been revealed via Meek Mill's social media almost a month prior. A lot of people were going on to say, is this what you want? Black women, look at this, da da da. Yelled. Well,
that dude right there that you just drove by, he was heated.
Yeah,
he was
him.
Superman.
So, the individual, what is his name? Who is calling me during a live?
Probably me.
I know. Meek's like, oh, I can give my opinion right now.
Listen, I'm a cool
man. What's his name? Killer Mike. Came to Meek Mill's defense. I don't know how many people know who Killer Mike is, but he's a very controversial man, okay? So the cover was public, okay, on the bus. And this guy, that guy, I think he's the one that's like, what the heck is this? This is the side of the bus rolling through your street.
This is what you want, black women.
All right. So Killer Mike said it's art. Absolutely. We as a society see naked humans in art museums. We should also be cultured enough as adults and parents to have a convo about nudity and art with our children. I say this as a parent, rapper, and a high museum of art board member. Love and respect. So he's saying, like, you know, this is... I kind of agree. Like, when you think about the Romans and, you know, just being in Vegas, walking through Caesar's Palace, like, you saw these type of sculptures.
Yeah.
Like, the boobs, the butts, and all this kind of, the wee-wees, the trees, and all that kind of stuff.
Right.
So it's like, now that black people are getting cultured and educated enough to portray these things ourselves, now it's supposed to be blasphemy. So that's the toss-up about it.
It makes me laugh how truly hypocritical society is.
Mm-hmm.
It's such a give or take. Like, you want us to be, and it's, I don't know what that dude's agenda was, and I think something I saw said that he was somebody's husband, which I think she was an African American woman. So I mean, he's vested in our culture for that. But to sit, I wonder if he did the same thing when he saw a WAP video, or the same thing when he said, you know what I'm saying? Like, do I like the bus? I mean, I think it was a little tasteless, per se. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like, rock that on a shirt or something. Or, you know, that didn't necessarily happen. But I'm not like, oh, I'm offended at how you portray black women. And look at how a lot of these black women are portraying themselves. They get in the bag from this. So maybe he was trying to help their bag by making it a little more normal to see that. I don't know.
But this is not and has not been the first or last time an artist as the album release, especially when they're going on tour, have not wrapped their tour bus with their art cover. Like, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, they do that all the time. I remember Jay had artists here years ago, Pitbull, and they wrapped their Range Rovers all with Pitbull's face and cover arts. Now, was his Pitbull's cover art, you know, booty cheeks and nipples back then?
Right.
No.
But it's a cartoon on top of that.
It's a cartoon.
If Robin Thicke would have took all the girls from the Blurred Lines video and wrapped all of them naked on a bus, there would have been no outrage. Nobody would have been outraged. You wouldn't have seen some black dude being like, white women, is this what you want?
And if I'm not mistaken, I think it was a black woman who painted that.
The cover art?
The cover art. I'm not sure. I'm not 100% for certain. I thought I heard Meek say that. Hmm. Or it could have been black woman cover art. And I thought he said it was black woman. Could have been that. But I don't know. You know, I just feel like, again, to each his own. Like you said, I do feel that it was kind of tasteless. But had this been him in handcuffs and, you know, a jumpsuit and a jail suit of his new album, no one would have said anything. If he would have wrapped that around a bus, no one would be talking about it. But because society loves to make women off money off of, you know, melanin women, and, you know, it's an uproar. So, you know, to each his own, that's my opinion. If you don't, again, if you don't like it, don't buy it. If you don't want to see it, don't look at it. Like, you know, let people freak flag fly, okay?
Right.
Let people do what they want
to
do.
My boy Kyle, who is a white man, says white people need to stop trying to speak for other racial communities.
People need to stop speaking about the people in general.
Like,
a man can't tell a woman what she should be able to do with her body about abortions and babies. This person should be able to tell somebody else how to feel about their body. And like,
at all.
Stop. What they say? Stay in your lane.
Stay in your lane.
Stay in your lane.
If you're in the go-kart, stay on the grass.
Thank you.
You know.
Thank you.
Everybody just has to, these days they know, and I guarantee you that dude knew that if he did what he did and put it online, he was going to get a bunch of clicks. So at this point, it's really hard. Yeah, it's hard to tell who's even genuine when they make
these type of things.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Is he doing that for clout, or did he actually feel that way?
What Cardi B said, they do everything for clout.
Everybody.
So, you know, to each his own. I'm excited to kind of hear what the Meekville album is like. And now that I think about it, didn't his album drop a while ago?
I found out his album dropped when I saw that video.
Yeah, his album dropped like, 2 weeks ago because...
I think I listened to
that. Oh,
what's up, brother?
Good brother. Y'all didn't tell me it was gonna be a surprise.
I popped in on him. I heard him on the air. And look, I'm driving. I hear him. I'm sorry. I know y'all do. Y'all live radio.
It's okay. We're live.
I didn't even know. I thought D. Clemens was his name.
Yeah.
You got all of us.
I switched it up.
I'm like, know who was his name. He was like, it's from the D and my Clemens. I was like,
never knew that story. Wow. 8 years later.
I'm sorry. Look, y'all broadcasting live. I had to come in and shock my guy.
Hey, Jada Gray.
This guy is family. Yeah. And he sound like a pro on the air.
Look, they got me cheating. Look, I'm cheating. This is real. Y'all see this?
Listen.
All the angles.
You sound like a pro. Like, literally,
I appreciate that.
It's in the blood.
Yeah, we got to negotiate something. You got to. We got to negotiate something. We got to.
I think y'all might got me.
Got to keep you here, baby.
Actually, I was just about to say something. You listened to the Meek Mill album when it first dropped, right? Which was a couple weeks. weeks ago. Mm-hmm. So why is this cover art like just now?
The
like,
controversy about the bus being wrapped with the cover art is what we're talking about. Yeah. I'm just
it's a woman. It's a woman that painted it. A black woman.
That's what I thought. Nina. Okay, so
yeah, she's
okay.
An amazing artist.
So
too.
That's what I thought. Nina. So okay. Man,
well, you heard it from Jay.
Look her up, Nina Abney.
She's
a very talented artist, but she's a black artist. She actually designed it. And if people do their history, it kind of was like showing from the past of how they used to show us in museums and different things. And so his thing was, I wanted to show how people could have an uproar about this, but the same people that have an uproar about this didn't have an uproar about, you know, old boy who died with the knee in the neck.
George Floyd.
And so people was telling him, don't tie those two in. But he was just saying, like, this bus and stuff like that, not real.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
if that can make you upset and you quiet on other things.
And that goes exactly to what we were talking about. Yeah. That man is a smart man. Y'all looking at him like, yeah. dummy, you talking about Meek Mill this, Meek Mill that. What you need to do is listen to that brother. Because he's trying to teach you something.
And, come on, can we not forget that we in America, sex sells. The porn industry is a multi-billion dollar industry.
Like, they watched WAP with Megan and Cardi and no one said anything. Like,
do we not know why we know of Kim Kardashian?
Right. Exactly.
Hello.
No matter what she's
she was styling. She was styling people with clothes for years. Y'all didn't know who she was until that tape came out of her and
Grace. So y'all need to quit acting like y'all innocent, man. Y'all know what's up.
Exactly. If you ask one person, like, who did Kim Kardashian clothe? They'd be like, exactly.
Ray J, bro.
But she was a fashion. She used to style celebs. But y'all didn't know her then.
Nobody knew that.
See? So sex sells. So at the end of the day, if it's consensual,
right,
it can't be offensive. If it's consensual,
exactly.
Right. Like, come on.
And it was a black female artist, like I said.
So now can we put all of that to bed now, y'all?
Exactly. Thank you.
Anybody who had a problem with it.
So you can't tell another race how to feel about a race who created it and promoted it.
It's ours.
Bingo.
Exactly. But I think people got an uproar because on the video he posted, it was a Caucasian man, like, taking the frame off. So they just assumed that he was the artist.
Oh, yeah, no. It's a black woman. Look up who designed me. I want to say her name was Nina. But her first name is Nina, last name is Abney. But she's a dope artist. But as long as it's consensual, listen, sex sales. At the end of the day, you want to see this world go bananas.
Right.
Let the porn sites shut down and let coffee shut down.
This world. You already saw what happened when OnlyFans almost.
Nina. Exactly.
Nina Chanel.
There you go. Yeah. Exactly. The OnlyFans.
Went crazy.
Come on, man. See? About to put a lot of girls out of work.
Right, I'm just saying. I got some friends I thought was going to be broke.
You did? But I'm definitely coming back next week to hang out. I had to hurt me here Friday.
Yeah.
So I'm like, I got to get in and see my guys. Listen, for those that don't know, and that listen, the dopest MC, I'm trying to tell y'all. That's why it's not a shocker that he's coming.
They heard that shit.
Man. You got, man. So, and she, Princess told me you're going to be a part of the cypher.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
And since you surprised me, I'm going to shoot you some emails.
There we go.
New stuff that's, I got going on.
So,
man.
Next week, I'm hanging out for sure.
Man, turn up.
I had to get in here today. Like, look, I got to see my guy real quick. So, it's a pleasure, man. You are a pioneer. Thank you so much, man.
I appreciate that, brother.
A pioneer in the music, a pioneer. I did a video a couple of weeks ago when we went, when we hit our numbers. We're like peaking 2 million now.
I saw that.
And a lot of people you know, who are in higher places thought this streaming or internet was a phase. Mm-hmm. And I can honestly say you definitely was one of the artists that was on it first. Knew that it was transitioning. Because a lot of artists didn't want to send music.
I was in there.
And you was on it, so you definitely a pioneer, man.
Since day one, man.
And now look, talk about is streaming and apps.
You know what? And we talked about that.
Ain't that crazy?
Monday, the first day he came on, and he was like, when we first brought up the U Store and the Good Time Show, he was like, I didn't even know what this was, and I was like, all right, I'm with it, y'all wanna, y'all.
Absolutely.
And he said, you know, since then, the U Store Awards, he was like, he still got his award, man. Like. So we were ahead of the curve.
Can you imagine if all of us would have got together and just patent streaming and online radio?
Well, now we got to patent the next thing.
Absolutely.
The world is ever changing, and the next best ours don't stop.
Yeah. So, hey, man. And the dinosaurs is switching over.
Oh, yeah.
Now everybody's like,
finally,
download the app. Go online, stream.
How do I download my pill app?
Exactly. But it's a pleasure. Y'all go ahead and finish. I'm sorry to mention y'all up. But I'm hanging out all next week because you back next week too,
yes,
right?
Sir.
My God. It's a pleasure, pleasure. All right, y'all finish having a good show.
History has been made.
I know, y'all. Woo. We keep it lit in the studio, y'all. You never know who's going to pop up.
Y'all don't understand who these people are, man. Like, these people really did something for me 8 years ago and made me believe in myself. And all through the year, you know, internet is the only place I've seen them. The first time I've met them in person was this week.
And which is crazy because over the 8 years, we've seen each other grow and stuff.
You
got married, and I was like, oh, yeah.
Like, there's certain friends you have on social media that you're, happy birthday, happy wedding, whatever. But these two individuals here, it was always 100% like, yo, family, like, what's cracking? I'm so happy for you. Like, can't wait to fly out one day. You need anything? Like, for real, for real. So.
And that's what people just don't understand. You know, that's always been our goal with the Gud Tymez Show, the network, like, everything. Creating a family-oriented base, because you know we could have been one of those stations that was just like, oh, you're just another artist that's on the network, boom, interview done, never talk to again, you know what I'm saying? Because a lot of stations do that, but we believe in everybody who, you know, comes on for an interview, whether it's a sponsor, whatever the case may be. We're very hands-on people and we're very close-knit, so we check up on people like years
that was
later,
a surprising
and we
thing
follow
too. Like,
and
throughout the years, having y'all continuously check in with me and us always talk, that was super, super weird to me. I'm like, what do you mean? Like, I have this thing where I don't ever feel like I'm that special to anybody ever, you know, and a lot of us probably have that, but they let you know how they feel about you. I've worked at large radio stations before, local radio stations that you hear in your car and all of that.
Yeah, because we were trying to steal you back then.
You know what I'm saying? I'm working at this place. And it's funny when you see major artists come through to those stations, and when they're interviewing, you know, they seem like, oh, yeah, we've known each other for years, we're close. Man, it ain't really like that.
Nah.
They barely even know each other's name. Remember that interview we did 6 years ago? Not really, but we're going to talk about, okay, so I'm going to bring up the interview and this is what we talked about. And a lot of that stuff's not real. And
it's
the Gud
Tymez really
Show, it is absolutely 100% authentic, real people.
We got y'all backs. We be locked in for life. I'm telling y'all, once you hit that puka puka, you in for life.
For real, I ain't escaped yet. And I done moved.
You puka puka
states.
For real. But listen, y'all, what we're going to do is we're going to hop into a couple of songs, and then we're going to come back and we're going to talk about the new series or the new season that just dropped of You. And if you guys have not watched any of the episodes yet, we're still going to just discuss You and this trend of these red flags that's been going on in social media. Because, you know, social media always got some kind of new trend. You know what I'm saying? It's always some trendy. So don't touch it down. Hit us up on social media and let us know what you guys think about the Meek Mill cover arts. And also check out the artist. I'm glad Jay came in and told me her name, because, like I said, I thought it was a black female artist. Her name is Nina Chanel Abney. Okay, if you search her hashtags on Instagram or anything like that, you will see her work. And her that's her type of work. Like, her work is cartoon type of thing. So search her and let us know what you guys think. Or, you know, pop it up on the chats or, you know, the lives.
Yeah, I love it.
At @Princess_on_air and @Cujo_speaks and @9397. Or call us 888-456-2157, extension number 2.
Let me hear your voice.
Don't touch it out, y'all. We'll be right back.
That was dope. I was wondering too, like, when Jay go?
Because his is like, his show is from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. now. So he, like, be out of here by the time I come in. So I'm glad he popped that in.
Me too. Oh, yeah. Man. Bucket list completed. Yeah, she dope.
Like, she does boobs. You know what I'm saying? Like, but when people don't know her as an artist, it looks offensive. Yeah.
I don't even that's think it's that offensive. Is that a real picture of her?
Yeah.
Why her smile was so animated?
I don't know. Wow. Yeah, I just, like I said, I just felt like it was people like she's showcasing.
Yeah.
What's always been in America.
Why is there a problem? I was surprised when I seen everybody was having all these issues. I'm like, about what? What's the issue? And it's not even like, you really gotta look. You gotta look to see what it is, too.
Yeah.
Like, it ain't like it's a big old vagina on the side of it. It's a little suggestive. It's suggestive.
Well, like Jay said, y'all can be, you know, offended by this. That's real painted cartoon character, like. But
right.
You know, they never found the killer of Kendrick Johnson, who his organs ended up missing, or the new guy.
His mom came out and said that was false. That it wasn't an organ missing.
The one Kendrick Johnson?
That was in the fountain of when the water.
No, not him.
Oh,
no,
the one that rolled up in the mat in the gym.
Yeah, okay. Him. No one ever found his killer. The one that just happened here that was found in the water or whatever. Him. No one still found his killer. No one was uproar about Sandra Bland. George Floyd. You know what I'm saying? Kanika Jenkins.
Brianna
Taylor. I can go on and on. I didn't see that guy making a video then.
They just made my day. I don't get surprised very much. I'm usually up on it.
I didn't even know he was coming today.
You probably would have told me if you had known.
I would have, because I thought he was going to come another day. Which one? I saw the live. I reshared it.
It's,
are you gonna stop it?
I'm about to stop it right now, probably. Let me go back in.
Dang, I can't believe it's only like 45 minutes left already.
It go quick.
I'm like, we even got to the rest of my topic.
Right. Everybody that I talked to that has been watching was like, man, y'all chemistry is crazy. Like, it really, y'all just be going on and on.
I'm telling you. Just a new thing.
Right.
And yes, y'all, I'm always snacking.
Always. Should make you hungry if you just ate. I meant to bring in some cashews. I gotta find my show snack. I feel like the cashews are too salty for me to eat on air. I'll be.
So, you know, what I mix together, and it's not even a real thing. I just did it and I tested it out. Sea salt raw almonds with peanut butter chips. Like, you know, like the little peanut butter, like Chip Ahoy's, not the chocolate chips, but the peanut butter.
Okay.
Mix them together. That's what I was eating in that cup. Oh, it's such a good, like, salty but sweet, like, balance.
Right.
Huh. I had made my own little trail mix. I've been on that since then.
I'm about to go on. There's an Instagram page called The Radio Fam. And I'm gonna write in on there, like, what are y'all show snacks? What's the best show snack?
In between song snacks, it's song break snacks.
Sultry and satisfying.
And a Red Bull.
It can't be messy and it can't be odorless.
Okay. Alright, y'all. I'm plugging in my charger. How y'all doing live? What they be saying? Hey, live.
What up, y'all?
Hey, live.
How y'all called? Sure.
Madeline, drip on me. Madeline, drip on me. See, people always trying to give me the shot. And buy stuff. I'll be getting text messages. Come shop with us now. Promo code.
I don't want to spend any more money. I don't want to. Stop. Stop trying to take my money.
Keep my money low, people. cold in here in the wintertime, or is it just always hot?
You know what? I don't know, because in the summer, we had AC. And it broke. And I think because the winter is coming in, I don't think they're using a rush for it.
No, I wouldn't either. That's not a bad idea. All right, y'all. I'm about to get out of here. If y'all want to keep listening, go ahead and go hot9397.com. Listen in, lab.
Or they can download the TuneIn app.
Dude, there you go. Get the TuneIn app. You know, I ain't even got to look at my ugly face. I got a face for radio on my mama's head. All right, y'all. Yeah.
Once upon a time when I heard that I was looking at you.
How come there's not an Instagram for a Gud Tymez Show?
So, we used to have, like, separate Instagrams for everybody, but it had become, like, too much to tell people, go follow Gud Tymez Show, follow Jay the Gray Show, and the network, so it's just a network social media. Okay. So, 9397 is just where everybody can find everything about all the shows.
There was, when I was at iHeart, man, I had... 92.3, 97.9, 100.3. We had two more stations too. We had to do all of the socials for all those pages.
This is so it's hectic.
Oh, man.
It definitely becomes like too much.
It was interesting.
Did you do sales here, or... No, you were engineer. You said
radio. I kind of did a little bit of sales. We're a promo team. The promo team really did everything. We had a whole sales floor, but we had to go out and do all the shit for the sales floor.
Oh.
And then, you know what I'm saying? All the events and all that shit, that was us. I wouldn't want to work sales for IRs. IRs, bro. They went bankrupt. A couple of years when I was there, they was talking about, what was it, 2016, 17? We were on a hiring freeze for like 6-7 months. They weren't allowed to hire nobody. And we had a couple promo people quit. So I think there was only like 6 or 7 of us on the promo team for like 6 stations. I'm talking working like my weekends. I had a Friday night club. So wait. All week we got events, right? Of course. But my weekend started with a Friday event during the day. A Friday night club live on air from like 8 to 11. Saturday morning, our band appearance with Mojo in the Morning. Whatever else they threw in Saturday during the day. Then I had a Saturday night club. And then there was always a Sunday event.
That's ridiculous. Yeah. So I'm working 7 days a week.
Pretty much, yeah. But your hours still wouldn't end up over like 30, 32 hours. They would work it out to where they would make sure your hours wasn't, but you had to work all these crazy ass. Then you lug in tents, speakers, games, all that shit. It was for $10 an hour.
Oh, yeah. Y'all can go.
It was wild. Did I get to do, see, and meet a bunch of cool people? Yeah, that was
because nice. I guess you look at it more as your experience. You know what I'm saying?
But it ain't. That shit don't pay the bills.
I think that would be cool, like, for young people, like, fresh out of high school, who geeked up about meeting people.
Right.
Who you really don't care about meeting people. Bro, that's not a good
one. I need that money. And at the same time, I just got... We didn't get laid off, but Fox Sports changed their format. So usually we would have the pre and post games for all the games, right? So I'm doing 3 or 4 games a week, so I'm bringing home, you know, $1,000 a week at that job. Then they went to all the home games, pre and post game would be done at the park. So now I'm working 1 to 2 games a month versus, you know what I'm saying? So I'm already hurting money, and now I'm working 32 hours at IR, and I'm going, right. And I got child support coming out of my checks at that point, because I just had a kid. My checks between both jobs, I think, were like $200 a month, or every 2 weeks. That's when I went back to Cali. I'm like, I gotta get the fuck out of here.
Yeah. So is the majority of your family here or in Cali?
Right here.
Oh, okay.
Only people I had in Cali is who I served with, but my family here, niggas all broke. Cause nobody helped me do nothing out here. So love me and give me a hug. If I go back out there, I know at least somebody gonna make sure I get back on my feet or try to help me.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
You got a better chance of surviving.
Pretty much. So I left in the first place.
Family,
what they say?
Chew you up, spit you out.
And it
makes
you clean yourself up.
Mm-hmm. You're like, you crazy.
Right. What you mean? I didn't do that.
You didn't have to.
Oh, well,
you didn't. You didn't make
fuck out
of choice.
But I'm always right. But I know how to shoot. But I know how to fight. I tell you once, I'll tell you twice.
As much as I can't stand his music, this song will always be the one that I gotta sing when you hear it come. That whole New York style that got hot after he got hot. Him and CJ the Whoopty.
Yeah, Whoopty.
That style of beat is annoying.
Yeah.
That song,
it's always like, it can only be around for so long. You know what I'm saying? It's not something that's like a forever type thing.
You heard that other cat that sounds exactly like Pop Smoke, right?
But I just think that people do stuff like that because look how that turned out for Designer.
Yeah.
After Panda, it was like, alright, what's next? Nobody play anything else. Nope. Timmy turd. We can learn for a bird.
I heard a Kanye song the other day that had that in it. Did he just take that song and added something to it or
which
something?
Which one, Panda?
Timmy Turner.
Oh, I don't know.
I want to say it was on his album or something. It threw me for a loop because it said Kanye, Designer, blah, blah. And it was a whole different song, and then it switched into that song. I'm like, this
thing. He probably did sample it.
No, he took the whole song playing. It wasn't a sample.
Well, he did that with, like a Pablo, too.
Did he?
He took that Panda song, and then he turned it on Like a Pablo. So, in my mind, I'm wondering.
That might be what I heard, then. It might not have been Timmy Turner.
Okay. I'm wondering, was Designer signed under Good Music then?
I don't.
Because I don't remember who he was signed through.
Look it up.
If y'all know, let us know.
Yeah.
See, these are the off-air conversations. You know, we've been here just kidding.
Well, Timmy Turner versus our teacher and Kanye. Was Kanye in that song?
I have no clue.
I'd be so behind on a lot of mainstream stuff, too.
You and me both.
I'll just hear and be like, oh, what is this? Like,
I stay in my bubble and I be in my world. Like, I don't get into who signed to who, this person signed to that network. Like, I used to.
I don't care.
But
I never have cared, really. Like,
it got to a point to where I was just like, okay, I'm not getting paid by that person. So why am I looking it up? Like, Teyana Taylor, I love her. But, you know, certain times when you don't look up people's labels and stuff like that, you don't understand why people's not dropping music.
Yeah, I think that's the only reason why. And I need to. Because when I get my studio back, even before that, I should be doing music now, but I'm doing these shirts. But once I start dropping music heavy and really making a push, I'm going to need to know who's with who and what kind of, you know. I almost had a deal out in L.A. And I found out what a 360 deal is, and I was like, no thanks.
At least you found out before, but not after like most people.
Well, I was slow on it, though. It was my fault. I didn't get it, but I'm glad that I fumbled that bag because I would have probably still been paying for
that. Probably.
To this day.
Yeah, they would have moved your shirt.
Man, right.
And you. And your music. Like, people don't understand. with those deals, man. People just want to be signed so bad. You know what I'm saying? One thing I can say, who said that? Was it Papoose? I think it was Papoose. When he was basically talking about, like, money, the money they made.
Let's do it. You know what I'm saying? I honestly would rather keep it that way. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'd rather have $100 come in and that $100 is solely mine instead of $1,000 coming in. I gotta divide this $1,000 by this person, that person, this person, that person, and be left with some chump change. That's the problem with, like, my stepdad. He still does shows and all that, right? But there's five of them in the group. So even if they get old, you guys are getting 10 grand.
You got to
crank that down.
Plus the band.
You know,
plus
right.
the tour and traveling people. Like,
man. Trying to do it where it's me. That's it. Oh, we need to talk about that trademarking thing, too. I want to get that done ASAP. So whenever you got some time.
Yeah, now that...
Whenever your next business day is, I was going to call whoever was on Google, trademark company, you know, help.
Yeah, you got to be careful with those, too. I tell people with LLCs, because they will own you. Mm-hmm. And I say they're registered for it, but they put their name down as owning it. They're leasing it to you.
Ooh. Yeah, I need y'all to get me right.
Yeah, I'll double check with Jay on how much it costs and how much.
Yeah. I'll try to let me know. And then I'm thinking about too. I'm wondering if I should full fledged have a separate LLC for the shirt making business. I'm already doing orders for people that need like work shirts and all that stuff. Or if I should just rock as a sole proprietor type of, you know what I mean? I don't know how much. I'm wondering if I should just go ahead and do that now. Because I want to be able to get the separate bank account for it and then do the website where you can...
Yeah, because with LLC, you can still get a touch ID number and all that kind of stuff. So I say LLC just because it's the most secure way anything ever happens. You don't have to send that email to you.
That's what I was thinking about. But I was thinking about scale, though. Like, I don't know how fast I'll scale to the point of needing an LLC or being that big, but...
But this is the thing. So if you get an LLC, let's just say you wanted to turn that into a record label, you can still keep the name because you own the name.
Right.
Because with the LLC, you don't really have to specify what the business is. It's okay. Just you own the name.
Right.
So you can take the name wherever you go.
Perfect.
So. If you like that name that much.
Right.
If
well,
not,
definitely,
then it's
I'm definitely going to trademark Andy Lux. I want that trademark for sure. I don't know if I want that to be the print business name or not or what.
Now, you could also do LLC and assumed names.
Okay.
So, with assumed names, what is up, everybody?
Yo.
I am your girl, the princess of all.
I'm Cujo Speaks.
And we are still here in the studio. Y'all remember this on my C-Pain?
That was C-Pain.
See, he has some classics. Oh, you know, okay, I got something like this real quick. So, I'm your girl, the princess of all.
Oh, I'm Cujo
Speaks. Oh, yeah, okay, he's Cujo. sorry, I had a quick thought, and
I was captivated by the thought.
I had to, like... This is so weird. Sometimes if I really want to remember something, I have to like tap my forehead in order for me to like remember it. So weird. I know. Whatever. Because if not, well, okay, let me remember that. And I don't. But if I tap myself, I'm like, okay, really? Remember that. Like, put it in your head. So, anybody watch the Netflix series? It's called something about like Life of Pop or like Real Pop or something like that. Okay. I'm going to look up the... Netflix TV show with T-Pain because he did a special on there because they do okay it's called This Is Pop that's what it's called This
okay.
Is Pop So they do different episodes with different people. I've watched like the first four. T-Pain was episode number, I think, four, if I'm not mistaken. But he just talked about how he got shunned so much for auto-tune. And I remember people talking about it, and, you know, Jay-Z came out with the death of auto-tune and all that kind of stuff. But he did not create auto-tune.
No.
You know what I'm saying? And watching that, like, it's like a little mini docuseries with him, and he talks about, you know, what he felt like, what he was going through. The first episode was Boys to Men, and then it was T-Pain with the auto-tune, and then they got one with Lil Nas X, and all, like, a bunch of people are on there talking about it. But I did not know Sheer, the song, she used auto-tune with her career.
There's a lot of people that have used auto-tune that you probably don't realize. You probably don't, because auto-tune was made to be a corrective tool. So it's supposed to make you hit the perfect notes. But if you use it in a certain way, or you apply more auto-tune than you need, that's when you get that robotic tone.
And that's what he did with it.
Yeah, he said turn it all the way up.
Her song, Believe. Do you believe?
Yeah, yes.
I did not know that was auto-tune.
Yeah.
I thought that was just her voice. But he was saying, like, you know, Usher came up to him and was like, man, you know, you didn't really effed up the game with the auto-tune stuff. Like, he was like, he went into such a depressed state because he's like, I didn't create this. Like, this is just something that I took and I used to enhance my music, and I thought it would be something that sets me aside from, you know, a lot of different people. And people failed to realize he had a lot of great hits and great music. Like, he is a really, really, like, he's a very talented artist. And even on, you ever seen The Cubicles or The Classroom or something like that? I don't know what it's called. The Office Space? I don't know. Where he he was singing, like, without auto-tune.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I think that's an NPR music. It's Tiny Desk.
Yeah, Tiny Desk. That's what it was. I knew it was somebody desk in the office.
I knew it was somebody something like class that. Somewhere.
And he was saying that was the most uncomfortable he had ever been, because he was like, I had to step out my comfort zone just to prove to people that I had talent that I already knew I had. But because he used auto-tune, people was like, oh, he can't really sing. He can't really rap. And he was like, I can't.
But his nervousness should tell you that he didn't even know anymore if he could or not. You know what
and
I mean?
He was like, at that point, he was doubting himself. Right. And, you know, it was just really good. So if you guys haven't seen This Is Pop, watch that on Netflix. You know, you can tell that I watched a lot during quarantine. You know,
I gotta watch that too. I watched there's something on Apple Music with Mark Ronson. I forget what the name of the show is. Okay. I will tell y'all on Monday.
Have Apple.
Because he really breaks down, like, every aspect of music and has a bunch of artists on. And he did speak to T-Pain as well about that whole same thing. And I will say, just to back up Usher, what he's saying was, he wasn't trying to be mean to him, but what he's saying is, you've now made it that people that aren't great at singing can now openly use this source because you just made it cool.
Yeah. But did he? Because Roger Rabbit.
But
you know,
he's a whole different.
It didn't look cool with that tube in his mouth. You gotta bite that thing and
iron ring. That's a whole different game.
That's probably how COVID.
T-Pain.
All these fuckers in the auto tune straw. That's how.
Don't
that's
use the same straw, fool. Yeah, he. Oh man.
Ah, that's funny. But speaking of YouTube, I mean not YouTube. Speaking of Netflix. This series that has came onto YouTube. It's called You.
I love it.
Have you watched any of it yet?
Not the third season yet.
Okay.
But I'm probably
going to binge it this weekend.
But you know what?
Shows like this really make my anxiety go through the roof. Like, I'm such a, like, visual, like, my imaginary and my imagination is, like, on level 12,000. That's why I can't watch those ICDC TV shows anymore. I can't do those.
Because I
be getting paranoid now. Like, I can't be outside.
But you gotta watch those to know what's up.
When it be like, because at one point in time, I was on bad binge. I did, like, the Tom, what was his name? The Bundy guy, Ted Bundy. I watched all of his. Yeah. I was just watching, like, everybody's. Man, when I tell you I was so scared to walk outside in the dark, I'm thinking Bundy gonna come from behind me. I was so
But on knowledge
edge.
Is power, though. Like, you woo. Know, if you know how all of them operated, right, then they
yes.
can't get you because you know, what you doing back there, sir?
I check my back seats when I get in the car. Like, I am fully aware. But you is coming back, and Joe puts me on edge.
He is. The funny part about when I first started watching it, too, I'd go into the comments and watch what people were saying about it, cause, you know.
Me too.
And then he's so cute, and I would date him, and he would, huh?
Man.
What's wrong with y'all people?
But you know what? This is what I would like to say about this. You know, people think that those kind of traits are cute. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And it's cute in the beginning when it's harmless, but you know, people don't pay attention to the real red flags. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So this trend that's on Facebook and Twitter and all that, people are posting these red flags. Like, I saw one, it was like, if you're over 21 and you still live at home with your mom, red flag. Like, y'all are looking over the wrong red flags. You know what a red flag is? A red flag is if I tell you how I feel and you get defensive and try to blame me and make me feel like I'm wrong for how I'm feeling, that's a red flag.
Red flag.
Because that's emotional abuse right there.
Like,
you know what I'm saying?
I don't think people these days even understand what the point of red flags are. That's something that warns you to stop and immediately evacuate the situation.
Thank you.
That's what a red flag is. Not something that you don't find endearing. Not something that a quality that you would like to go without. It's something that means, hey, you are in danger. You need to not continue doing this with this person.
That's why a lot of people...
If he ain't making six figures, that's a red flag. A red flag for what?
Thank you. Because you can't mooch off him?
Or he'll go digging bug and have to work?
That's not a red flag.
No.
A red flag is if, you know, he's being very aggressive in a conversation when you tell him he's wrong.
Right.
That's a red flag.
My homeboy said on Facebook, you know what I mean, with the grass and the red flag, like
yeah.
the golf hole?
Yeah.
He said, my red flag looked like this because it's still greener on this side. Like, you are the problem, sir.
That is true.
You are
that
the problem,
so true.
Sir.
Like, people look over those things. Like, if a guy is, you know, very, very clingy and he's finding out, like, you know, your locations without you telling him where he's going, or a girl is very clingy and she's finding out your locations without you telling her, those are red flags, honey. Yeah. Okay? Because, sir, how are you finding this out? Like, when he was, like, be knowing where she was at in some of the episodes,
yeah.
like, standing outside her window, knowing her ex-boyfriend, and, you know, if, this is another red flag that people very, very much overlook. If we're dating, right, and you go, like, friend, like, all of my friends, like, all of my exes and stuff
yeah.
like that, also, that's a red flag. What you want to
yeah.
friend them for? You don't know them in real life.
Right.
What you trying to find out? Red flag? Because that's what he was doing. He was going to, like, follow the ex-boyfriend and all.
And she was blind, like, not even just blind, like, obliviousness. Like, you ladies, y'all need to, as much as y'all talk about there ain't no good men left and this, that, and the other thing, and the men y'all end up with, y'all just need to be a little more observant. Because they tell you, I see who they are while you're dating them. And you go, no, he's not usually like this. When I hear that, for one, to me, that's a red flag that you are covering up for that man.
Yes.
And you are either scared to leave him or you really don't see what I see.
But you know, people don't know that emotional and, you know, verbal abuse is real.
Yeah.
Like, people feel like, oh, if I don't have a bruise or he didn't put his hands on me, that's not abuse.
It don't matter.
And, you know, if someone is controlling, manipulative, all those kind of things, that's a form of abuse, y'all. Like, we need to stop looking over those things because those are ultimately some of the red flags.
Oh, yeah.
Kris Jenner, when you saw him trying on your panties and your makeup,
yeah,
red flag.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I'm saying? And I'm not being funny,
no.
but they talked about how they saw
like
him on different things.
Right.
She was like, oh, you know, I saw him playing my lipstick. And, you know, one of the girls said that they walked in on him trying on some stockings and stuff. Like,
should've
red
asked
flags.
Right then. And that's my
red
thing,
flags.
Too. Like, I understand that as in a relationship as a couple, you have to really learn each other and you have to become, mm-hmm. you know, so there is there's a learning process, but during that learning process, when you see something, say something. You can't just see something, overlook it, and then when that thing that you saw comes to fruition and it's something detrimental, right, I had no idea. Well, this one time I did think, but I just didn't say nothing. Okay, why not?
Now, let me ask you this, because, you know, red flags go into, you know, remarrying and divorce and things like that. Now that you're older and you're wiser, can you think about things in your first marriage that you were like, you know, that was a red flag, but I overlooked it?
The whole entire marriage, to be honest with you. I mean, we were young.
Not the whole thing.
Oh, man, the whole thing. It was a farce. Man. It was a complete, she played me. I was young in the military. I just got in the military. And in the military, anybody who's in the military or has been in the military, you know that young military folks get married to get more benefits.
Yeah, and so that they can live together.
Yeah, move off base and live in a house. Yeah. So we both got orders to deploy shortly after getting together. And granted,
so you both were in the service?
We both were in the service.
Oh,
we met
okay.
And on base. So we were supposedly in love, whatever, got married, yada, yada, yada. Turns out, I found out it was all false, it was all fake, whatever. So I never wanted to get married again because I'm like, it's not real, it's all fake. Like, there's no way that anybody...
It's all paperwork, that's how it was the first
right.
time.
Right. Even when I met my now wife, both of us have been previously married, both had kids by in other marriages or whatnot,
yeah.
And we both said to each other, I don't even care if we get married. It's not even that important to me. It's just paper or whatever, whatever. But through time and through that closeness and that love for each other, it was like, I can't not marry you. It wouldn't feel right. You know, so red flags or not, you got to know what you want. You have to. You only see a red flag if you put up strong foundations and strong barriers for yourself. If you have for sure things that you will not accept in your life, then you have red flags to show you that that person is going to be or is the kind of person you said you don't want.
But then I sometimes even feel like some of them are not red flags per se, like, oh my gosh, I need to leave and, you know, be gone. Some of them are just deal breakers that you grow to be accustomed to.
Yeah.
Or let's say, I'm not going to say deal breakers, but like, what was that list that girls used to put? Like their standards.
Yeah,
oh,
right.
I only date a guy that plays this and date a guy
instance,
that's like that.
My wife had 5 kids but when I met her. Most men, or most women, most anybody would have a hard time being with someone with 5 kids.
That's true.
And before I met her, and that's why it's so different for me, because when I met my wife, the moment I met my wife, everything I thought I wouldn't accept or want, or all that went out the window. I didn't care about nothing but being with that woman.
And that's where I go to say, if you love somebody and you like somebody, you look over those standards or what you would once call a deal breaker.
Right.
Because it was the same thing for me. I never wanted a guy who, you know, smoked or, you know, wasn't organized and all these kind of things. And my fiance, he did it all. And I was like, I don't care. Like, you know what I'm saying? But through time, you know what I'm saying? Yes, he's changed his ways. He doesn't do half those things anymore. Except for, he's still messy. But, you know, that's all men. You know, that's all men. You know, I'm not going to just fault him. But, you know, I think that love and relationships can definitely open you up to be a different person than you originally started out to be. And I feel like that's what a good relationship is supposed to do. It's supposed to bring out the better.
Well, you have to know what you're willing to let go of and what you're not. And that comes down to where the red flag should be. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You shouldn't, I don't think it should at all be anything that's monetary.
No.
By any means. It shouldn't be about where that person lives, their station or situation in life. It should all be about that person's person.
And
who
how they
are
make
they?
You feel.
Right. Who are they inside? Who are they as a person? And I mean, of course you have to be sexually attracted to the person you're going to be with. So I'm not saying, you know, sometimes you know what you like and what you're not going to be attracted to.
Yeah.
Of course. But even be willing to give it a shot.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? There's a lot of y'all out there that are 35, 40, 50 even, who are single because you sit at home and you want this, and you won't accept nothing else when yo butt ain't checking off no boxes
your
on nobody's list.
This,
you know
this,
what I'm saying?
This.
You ain't checking off no boxes on nobody's list either. So
I say that all the time. You cannot, and it's just across the board. You cannot give someone something that you don't have.
Right.
You can't expect someone to give you something that you don't have.
Right.
So as a woman, you can't be like, oh, I want a man who, you know, is have his own house, his own car, a job, and no kids, but you still live at home with your mom, you know, you may have a car, you know, your job is up and down, you have a child or two. Like, you can't, with dating, you have to go in it with, I'm just going to say, no standards.
Mm-hmm.
Because you never know how a person may make you feel. You may look at someone and be like, oh my gosh, I would never date someone like that. And then you give them a try and you're like, this person makes me happy.
It's
like, oh my goodness. Like, it's just crazy. And even with Jeannie Mai, and she just redid another podcast of saying, like, why she changed her mind about having children. And she went on to say, like, in her previous marriage, like, she never felt safe. So she was abused when she was younger. I don't know exactly, like, the details of it because I missed that upload of her show. I'm sorry. But she was abused somehow. And, you know, she felt like she wasn't safe with her family and people knowing and not protecting her.
Right.
So with her dating her mate, you know, they just, they loved each other, but they weren't on the same page. So she just felt like, why would I want to bring a child into this, you know, dysfunction? And a lot of people feel that way. A lot of people, if their situation is not right, they feel like, why would I want to bring a child
that's
into this?
And that's how you should feel. I mean, honestly, ladies, I wish y'all would feel like that more. Because there's a lot of y'all that are
having kids
for a bag and not really setting these kids up for success. And it is so sad to see.
It's heartbreaking.
So sad to see.
And she went on to say that, you know, when she met Jeezy, they both had agreed, like, we don't want kids. Jeezy had already had two kids. She didn't want any kids. So they were just like, oh, kids is out the question, whatever. But as they started growing together and, you know, loving each other, they're like, you know, we want to create something together that we can call our own. And she was like, that ultimately made her change her mind, because for the first time in her life, she felt safe. She felt happy. She felt that someone had her back. And, you know, especially being a first-time mom, like, everything is, or a first-time dad, everything is so, you know, brand new. It's so foreign. So you have all these thoughts of, am I a good mother? Can I, you know, really take care of this child? Am I a good father? You know, what am I going to pass down to them? Like, I've had trauma, but, you know, am I going to be able to not pass that down to my child? Like, but those are all emotions that every human being on this earth has when bringing a child. I'm gonna hope.
If you're any kind of
figure, thank you.
You will have that.
You know, I would hope that when women get pregnant, that's what they're thinking, and not just, huh, I'm gonna have this baby, you know, the government gonna take care of me.
I know so many women who live off the bed. Let me tell you, as a man who pays child support, I pay an arm and a leg a month for my child. And these women who have 5, 6, 7 kids and are listen, child support is going to get that money from the father.
Oh, yeah.
If you don't pay that money, there is a warrant out for your arrest and you will be arrested. So, they're paying, these women are getting that money, and that's how they're living, is off of that money. Not supporting the kids, that's how they are living.
So, let me ask you something, and you don't have to share if you don't want. Because this is how I always look at it. First of all, I don't believe in child support. I hate it. It's the dumbest thing ever. But, so say the amount that you pay per month, does she actually see that full amount? Do you know?
A little bit less. It's like a couple dollars less.
Is it like a significant amount less? Or?
I think she gets the majority of it. But it's still, to me, it still doesn't work out because I end up paying like taxes or whatever it is on it, right?
Uh-huh.
So I end up paying extra. But when I make that payment on the first, she doesn't get that payment till like 8th or 9th. Or even 10 sometimes.
And that's the part that I just think is so stupid.
It goes through the system first, it gets blah, 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 and then it goes to, I'm like, okay, so if that's really supposed to be to support my daughter,
what if the bills are
what's
going to happen between that time?
Why doesn't she get that money immediately?
And this is why I feel like, with child support, this is just my opinion, I feel like if a man is paying child support or if a woman is paying child support, I don't have to give you anything extra. You decided that that's going to be everything, because I don't have it to give to you extra, first of all. Like, I still have other bills and things that I have to take care of in my life. And secondly, I think that if people came together, got an attorney, notarized, you know, an agreement, that money, like you said, if I'm giving a full 5, you would get the full five.
Right.
Instead of the taxes, the processing fees, and all that stuff, which breaks it down to about three something.
Right.
You're losing if you go through the state, because the state is going to tax you. They're going to get their money. It's a business.
The sad part, too, is if a woman is taking any kind of state aid, regardless of what you want to put them on child support or not, they're going to put you on child support
to pay for that
state aid, right? Now, if you're on child support, you have to, even if the mother says, I don't want him to be on child support anymore, you guys have to file a petition, go to the court, and then the judge will decide if you can get off child support. It's not even your choice at that point.
That's why you should never get on it to begin with.
The whole system is just make a baby with somebody you'll be with forever. Like, if y'all decide to amicably split, then amicably figure out the money.
But also, they need to do a better job at educating mothers and fathers about when bringing a child into this world.
Yeah.
So, because my parents were a little bit more experienced, they were able to guide me and my fiance when I, you know, had my first child, letting us know that if you don't have insurance in that baby, the state automatically picks it up, and that's how the dad automatically gets put on child support. In my case, we had already had our insurance company prepared, ready for when the baby would be born. All I had to do was mail in the birth certificate and the social security number once I got it.
Right.
To where he never had to get put on child support. But they don't teach that to first-time moms and first-time dads. So the state automatically picks up and covers the bill, and boom, now you're on child support.
And that's if you're not married. If you're married,
if you're not married.
So y'all need to know, okay, free people, game Friday.
How many people are
exactly
married
not a
before
lot.
That? And
not
that's
lot.
How a lot of couples, you know, get that friction, because it's like, you put me on child support. No. And she's like, no, I didn't. What are you talking
for
about?
For instance, I was in California, and I realized, because I owed at this point, for one, they didn't start my child support until 6 months later, right? We asked for that to be the thing. But we didn't know that they were going to backdate until the day she was born.
That's how they do.
So I started child support with like $2,000 in the hole. So that $2,000 carried, and it turned out I had a warrant out for my arrest. And I'm living in California, and I find this out. So I'm thinking, she done went to court, and that done put did money.
Yeah.
The whole time, it was how the system was
set up.
And it's state by state, too. Every state's different.
Yeah, every state is different.
So, fellas, just protect yourselves. If there's anybody out there listening right now who has a pregnant girlfriend and y'all are either on the rocks or whatever, like, please look into it, because you're going to get swept up into the system sooner than you think you are. And
even if, let's just say, you know, you have that child, like you said, it goes back to the day that they were born. Let's just say you guys had your child now, you guys get married a year later. You technically still have back child support for a year because the state picked it up. If you don't already have an insurance company, you know, covering that, or if you don't pay out of pocket or pay cash and all those kinds of things. And those procedures are very, very pricey. You know what I'm saying? So,
if I'm not mistaken, you end up, the mother is on health care from the state too, and your child support has something to do with that as well.
Yes,
I'm pretty sure. If I think we had spoken about it, and I was talking to her about it, but she would lose her health care if I got off child support or something to that effect. So what I mean, like, fellas,
make it very, very tricky, because some states, you know, the father doesn't even have to be present in order for their name to go on the birth certificate.
Oh, yeah.
And that's where they were having an issue too, because a lot of women were just like, yeah, such and such is the daddy, and they were putting him on there. They were putting random men's names on these birth certificates.
Yeah, we gotta. I'm gonna look some stuff up, because
we gotta have a show about
because
that.
Because I've seen cases where the paternity test said it wasn't,
but because there was an X amount of time,
right? And you still are like, fellas, I'm telling, we need to get together. We need to research.
You know, we got some games to give. Okay, y'all.
Princess is an advocate for us, man. She's looking out for
us. I am. Because listen, at the same time as I am a woman, I'm a woman raising three boys.
Hey, praise.
And I know how women can be, and I am not letting none of you little skeezers get over on my baby. Okay?
Like that.
Y'all not getting over on them. So. And you know, that's why we just have to be more mindful. As much as people are always like, you know, in men's ears to be independent and do this, da, da, da. We gotta be in these women's ears, okay? Because one thing my dad has always taught me, and I've never ever like thought differently, and I live by this from the day, always have your own money when you're doing anything. Don't assume that a man is going to pay for your dinner. Don't assume a man is going to cater to you or take you out. You know what I'm saying? They can, you know, out of the niceness of their heart, but they're not obligated to.
Right.
You know, when I would go out on dates and hang out with dudes for, like, the first time, I always had my end to cover my bill. Because you ain't never about to jit me or make me feel like, oh, I covered the bill. What you going to cover?
I'm very proud of my daughter. I told her years ago, like, I want to make sure you know how to do everything a man's supposed to do for a woman, so you never need a man to do the things a man's supposed to do for a woman.
Exactly.
I don't want you to need a man. I want you to want a man, find a man, and love that man, not out of need, necessity.
And that's the part that we have to raise our daughters.
Man, we got to do better.
You don't need anybody but God. Now, would you like someone? Would you want someone else? Sure. But you don't need anyone.
It'd be fun, but it ain't supposed to be. Like, I hate when people say I was only half a person until I met you. No, you were a full person.
Exactly. You only operated with half of you, but you were a full person.
You were 100% you.
100% human. Now, the last time I checked, you had, you know, two arms, two legs, two abs. Like, you know what I'm saying?
That's not my
son. Now, your brain might have been half. I'm just kidding. But listen, y'all. Sadly, it is time for us to go already, okay? So we've just been spitting free game with y'all all day. But we got more for y'all next week, okay? Don't think that this is the end, because this is just the beginning.
It's going down, y'all.
It's going down. Meet me in the mall. Going down.
With your own money, because I ain't paying for it.
Hey, me neither, because I'm cheap, okay? I got coupons. Listen. And I say this every so often because I want people to really mark my words. When I say I don't care how much money I have, I'm still going to be cheap. I got money now.
It's called
even
frugal.
If I, thank
what
you.
We call it frugality.
Frugal. Even if I got $1 million in the bank, $2 million in the bank, I'm still going to be frugal.
I mean, I'm falling apart.
I had ready a quarto. Okay, I want the 4-in-1 for that cheap price. Okay, I'm not spending $1,500 on those shoes. I'm not doing it. You can mark my words. Thank you. Okay, ShoeDepot.com. Just fab. Okay, ShoeDazzle. Like no.
Free game Friday.
I'm not spending $2,000 on no bag. You know what I'm gonna do? I'm so smart. I'm gonna make my own bag. I'm gonna make my own shoe.
Ooh.
Cause that's just me. But I'm letting y'all know. I'm a couponer, okay? Clip it and buy.
I need to get up on that. I got too many kids to be spending more money than I need to.
Now I'm not that like overly like you, but I really wanna get into it. Like how people be like going and like doing a whole shop and spend like 10 cents.
No, they be making.
I saw that they get cash back.
I got homies that have done it.
I need a class. I need a class on that. Listen, if y'all can, y'all want to give us a class on how to coupon and make money off your coupons, please. I know people who are like, man, give me a coupon so I can do this survey on there, man, so I can get this money back. And I'm like, survey? What are you talking about?
Take it.
Like, here. Now, I do the fetch, where you scan the coupons and you get points. It's like the Ibotta type of thing.
You have a lot to teach me.
I do. See, look, we're gonna be teaching, okay, y'all. But any last minute shout out before we get out of here on this Friday?
Man, as always, my beautiful wife and my beautiful kids at home. I love y'all so much. Thanks for always holding me down. And everybody who tuned in today, I'll thank y'all personally instead of calling y'all out right now. Thank y'all so much. I love y'all so much.
Yay! Are you going to see the new Halloween movie this weekend?
Might try to stream it. I think there were some places we could stream it.
Okay.
I might try to do that. And I think I'm going to take the kids to see Tilson Street. If anybody hasn't seen Tilson Street in the area, I heard it's the jam. I've never been. But you might be able to catch me out that way.
Okay. Well, I might try to see the Halloween movie. I don't know. I'm just so over the whole Jamie Lee Curtis saga. But whatever. But listen, y'all. Continue to follow us on social media at Princess_OnAir, at Cujo_Speaks, and at 9397. All right. I hope you guys have a fun-filled weekend. Please remember, do not drink and drive. There's Uber, Lyft, taxis, everything. Please be responsible this weekend. Be safe. Be smart. It's been fun. It's been trill. It's been so freaking real.
I got it right.
Until Monday for good Monday. Ladies, stay pretty and kings stay kingin'. Deuces.
That was a good show.
I know.
That's real. three good shows. That's three good shows.
Three in a row, we three for three.
That's three good shows. Man, can't nobody tell me that one's a good show.